glad you're here. If you're catching this online, glad that you have joined us as well. As we wrap this up, I want to kind of do what we've been doing at each of these, and people have been kind of saying some of their regrets, you know, usually some lighter ones, some funny ones. I thought, well, what do I got, you know? What do I got for regrets? And I thought, you know, I regret that when I got a Fitbit a few months ago that I didn't read any of the instructions, because what I did was I went out, you know, for a walk, and it was a little cold, so I'm walking about halfway into it, but I'd had my hands, you know, in the pockets here of my sweatshirt, and I get about halfway into it, and I thought, well, let's check the progress. And I look at it, nothing. I didn't know you have to do this. Because if you don't do this, you get nothing. When I work out, I want credit, you know, and it's sad that I call walking working out, I know. But nevertheless, so on the way back, I'm halfway into it, so I just, you know, walk back same pace, but I was there. And I'm driving home, it's like, according to Fitbit, I went like 60 miles that day by the time I was done. It was awesome. Should have read the instructions. I regret that. When I was 16, I jumped on my motorcycle, went for a ride, and out in the country, and I'm riding along and come around a corner, and a German Shepherd jumps out in front of me. And I clip it, and I go down. The dog was fine before. Let's just establish that so you don't. Oh, what about you? So, you know, I'm really regretting, though, that day that I wore shorts, a tank top, and flip-flops as I became a human eraser going across there. It was definitely a regret. And this week, I was going golfing with Pastor Robert Flores at our Torrey Pines campus. And we were going to meet. He wasn't there yet, so I thought, well, I'll just use the restroom. And I comfortably seated, and I look down. I see shoes, Robert's shoes. So I'm wrapping things up, and I say a few things to Robert, and wasn't Robert. And I regret being so funny. And going ahead and talking to God knows who. I just got out of there when I realized it wasn't Robert, so I just moved on. So, you know, we've got regrets. And just if this is your first weekend with us, here's what we've been covering. The three types of regrets. Regrets of action. Why did I do that? Regrets of inaction. Why didn't I do that? And then regrets of reaction. Why did I compound one mistake with another? Why did I follow it by even making it worse by something I did or something you did? We've been in this for 4 weeks, and my hunch is that if you've got some big regrets in your life, you're not necessarily over it now because we did this series. That you might still feel like you're a little bit stuck in this as well. Too many of us feel the pain of riding the sorry cycle. Now, that is certainly a sorry cycle there, but that's not the one we're referring to. This is the one we're referring to. That idea of, you know, I really want to be free, and then you just, it leads you into another regret, and then you want to be free, and you get stuck riding this sorry cycle. We can't escape this back and forth between, you know, longing to be free and then further regret. Well, the good news, we looked at a three-step process to start over. First of all, we recognize our regrets, face them head on, be honest with yourself and with God, and then release our regrets, which usually involves either seeking forgiveness or offering forgiveness to someone else. And then redeem our regrets. We invite God to do what only God can do, where he can take something bad and use it for good, that he would make use of and bring good from even some big-time regrets. Well, in this process, one of the things that often is part of it is something called repentance. And repentance means that, you know, you were going one direction and you turn around and you do a 180. You head the other way. It's a turning. It's something that you make a decision. I was going that way and now I'm going that way. And repentance is something that is, you know, lights on, windows open. Everything's out there. I'm not trying to repaint it or rephrase it, trying to, you know, make it sound like it's not as bad as it was or it wasn't my fault. Or, well, here's why I did what I did. It's none of that. It's just like, I was wrong. That was wrong. I'm sorry. Please forgive me. I had a professor at seminary, a guy named Lewis Smeeds, he said this: never allow an apology to do the work of repentance. And what I mean is a lame apology. You know, have you ever had somebody come up to you and say something like, well, if I hurt you, I'm sorry. That is so lame. You want to respond, well, if I slap you, I'll forgive you. You know, it's like, what? Just, you know, if I hurt you, oh, shut up. You know you did, and it is your fault. So just don't do a lame apology. We have been inviting people each week to go out to the regret walls on the patio and, you know, write a regret. And as part of that idea of you know, releasing it, you know, putting it outside of you in some way. And today what we're going to invite you to do is go out there and paint over regrets. Cover them. Because that's what God wants to do. He wants to cover our regrets. If you're taking notes, the message big idea is living beyond your regrets is not a one-time fix, but a daily decision to surrender to the Holy Spirit. It's a daily decision. It's not like, well, one time. Well, I prayed that prayer before. I, you know, took that step and it, you know, it didn't take. Well, it's a process. It's a process that we get there as we continue to make the right choice. God redeemed, you know, a regret of mine. I quit high school, you know, in my senior year. Pretty bright. And I had reasons. You know, it's like, hey, I've got a great job at a car wash. I've got plenty of money for pot. Why do I need school? You know, it was really good future planning that I had going on at the time. Anyway, as soon as I did it, I knew it was a mistake. And so I went to college. I've talked a little bit about that before. Just suffice to say, I lied and got into college. And yeah. Anyway, then I quit college. And just kind of always felt, you know, like that was an area of my life that was one of those things that was tough for me, you know, because I'd been told that academics probably wasn't going to be for me. I wasn't quite there. I was a little slower than everybody else, you know, and I didn't know it at the time, but, you know, like ADD, and all kinds of other stuff, but, you know, shiny things went by, and so, you know, I kind of had trouble in school and paying attention and, you know, staying focused. At any rate, when I was 36 years old, I felt like the Holy Spirit told me to go finish school. And, you know, at that point I'm married, I've got two kids. And in order to pull it off, we had to sell the house, move, pay for our school and all that. So we were starting over. And I want you to know that the day I registered for those classes wasn't the victory day. Because there were like, you know, 780 days of school after that I had to keep choosing. It's that daily surrender, that daily choice. And I believe we, and that's the point of this, is that in order to start over, there is the daily choice. And we need help. And we need some strength and power beyond ourselves. Look at this in Ephesians chapter 3. I pray that out of his glorious riches, he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all the Lord's holy people, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. And the idea there that we would grasp it's like the idea, the picture that's painted there in the original Greek is that we would be ambushed by this love of God, that we would be blown away, that we would see it for what it is, and it would rock our world, that he absolutely loves me, and that when you would begin to see how God feels about you, instead of having fear or anxiety about it, you would have joy, that there would be a peace that would come with it because he absolutely loves you. That's what this is talking about. It was surprising to me that as I began to follow Jesus, that it wasn't about me doing everything right. I was surprised that following Jesus wasn't about me having righteous performance and getting everything accurate and not making any more stupid mistakes. That wasn't what it was about. It was about growing in a relationship of love and acceptance and forgiveness. And so that when there was change that was taking place, when there was growth, it was motivated by love rather than some sort of fear of punishment or rejection or disappointment of God in me. That wasn't the motive any longer. See, the path to real change was surrender, not trying to gut up perfection. And that is a much more freeing place to be. John Ortberg is one of my favorite authors. He wrote a book called The Me I Want to Be. And in it, he uses the 12 steps of AA to demonstrate the power of surrender versus the weakness of willpower. Here's what he says. In which of the 12 steps does it say, now try really hard not to drink? In which of the 12 steps does it even say, now decide not to drink? Amazingly enough, the most powerful tool against the most powerful addiction in the world never asks people to decide to stop doing what is destroying their lives. Instead of mobilizing the will, its followers surrender their will. Try to overcome the problem by your will, and it will beat you. Surrender your will, and sobriety becomes possible. Surrender, which we think means defeat, turns out to be the only way to victory. This is not just the case with alcohol. It is true with other addictions, with habits, with brokenness, and with sin in general. This idea of surrender carries with it that you're going to surrender to someone who loves you, who is powerful, someone you can trust. So how does this surrender to the Holy Spirit help me start over? Remember, it's not a one-time fix, but this daily, regular, consistent starting over. And often it's like two steps forward and one step back. But if you're susceptible to kind of a performance-based relationship with God, you'll take two steps forward, but if you take one step back, you give up. I'll never get it right. How could God love me? I keep making the same mistake. Instead of getting up and starting again, starting over again. See, one of the definitions for maturity around here is, I'm a quicker repenter than I used to be. Not that I never make a mistake, but that when I make that mistake, I don't wallow in it. I don't throw in the towel and give up for a period of time or give myself, you know, license to, well, I screwed up. I might as well really screw up because I'm such a screw up. No. Turn quickly. Grow further. So how does this surrender thing help me? Well, number one, the Holy Spirit empowers me. Every day we face pressures that are coming at us. Whether you are a student, whether you are single, young adult, whether you are married with kids or an empty nester, maybe you're single again. Whatever it is, there's all different kinds of pressures that are coming at us. And so in order to walk in this transformative kind of life with God, we need to have power beyond ourselves. We need to have a power within us that is greater than the pressure from the outside, the pressure that's coming at us. Or what do? We'll crumble. We'll fall under the weight and the pressure that's coming our way. That power is the Holy Spirit. That word power is another little Greek word called dunamis, where we get the word dynamite. It's this explosive power that God offers to us. This transforms my life. But I must first surrender my life, making it available for that transforming power to be a part of it. Then the Holy Spirit moves in and begins to change even the way I think about life, about myself, and about God. Begin to change the way I think about all of that. It's this inside-out transformation. He begins to deconstruct some of the foundations that I've built my life on, some foundations that are based on things that aren't even true, maybe even outright lies. I believe that many of us have faced either people or situations where there are sort of this voice in the back of your mind that maybe a teacher, a parent, someone of influence in your life said something negative, and it just rings there, and you think it's true, whether it's true or not. But it is sort of debilitating. And God wants to bring His word to you. God wants to bring His truth to you. And as He's deconstructing those, you know, false foundations, right alongside of it, He is building a foundation that you can live on. Building a foundation that is going to take you to a space and a place where you're becoming all that God intends for you to be. Not out of some weird performance thing, but out of this relationship of love. You become who God intends you to be. At that point, I can begin to face down some of my insecurities, deal with some of my fears, even begin to allow Him into some of the hurts and disappointments and even the false belief systems that I've built my life on. And any thinking that keeps me from believing that God really is for me, not against me, that He loves me, and that He has a wonderful intentions for my life. And I know for some of us, you maybe you've even been walking with Jesus for a long, long time, but it's hard for you to believe that Jesus just absolutely loves you right now. Oh, but I kind of had a bad week. Well, you know, it's okay, you know. Repent quick. Deal with it quickly. Move ahead now, because God loves you right now. Now, I want that to sink in a bit, because some of you immediately dismiss that. Well, I wish that was true. Shut up. It's true. He's with you. He said He'd never leave you or forsake you. He's absolutely in love with you. That's why it's called grace. Because you might be thinking, but you know, I make so many mistakes. I don't deserve His love. I'm totally jacked up. Okay, that's probably true. But it doesn't change the fact that He loves you. And as jacked up as you are, He can heal you. He can help you. And He's committed to it. He wants to. It's about our choices now moving forward. What are we going to do with it? Are you going to continue to let those voices from the past, oh, you'll never amount to anything? You know, no one's ever going to want to be with you. So what do we do? Those voices cause us to make other choices to kind of deal with that, and then we end up with these regrets. If we're trying to live out our life based on things that just are not true or good. Matter of fact, jot this verse down. It's Romans 12, 2. Let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Often the challenge of this transformation come from our thoughts, the way we look at ourselves or God. Because if we begin to change the way we think, we can change the way we behave. And we need this power. NASCAR drivers, they use high-octane fuel to get the most power out of that engine. You know, elite Olympic athletes, we eat food that is, what? Really good for us. Uh-huh. Okay. See, how I think about myself is part of the fuel that powers the choices that I'm making. And those choices end up being what, you know, can form a life of regret or freedom from regret. So what's fueling yours? The Holy Spirit wants to open my eyes to and then learn to embrace the identity that I have in Christ. Who I am in Jesus. And often, my identity in Christ, who I am in Jesus, is going to be counter to some of the ideas, thoughts, feelings that I have about who I am. Matter of fact, last year we did a series called Essence, where we dug deeper into this whole identity in Christ and what that really means. And we had a phrase that went through the entire series. Let me read it to you. I'm not a sinner who sometimes gets it right. I'm a saint who sometimes gets it wrong. But you know what? If I went to you and said, hey, do you feel like you're more of a sinner or a saint? Most of us go, oh, man, I'm definitely a sinner. And there's truth that you do sin. But the reality is God says you're a saint. That's part of your identity. You're a saint. Now, you haven't been canonized, and the Pope hasn't done anything, but, you know, it's still true. You're a saint. You sometimes get it wrong. So repent quickly. Don't wallow in it. Move forward. See, that's the kind of thinking that powers us out of that sorry cycle. When we begin to believe that this is true. One more verse to write down. Philippians 4:8. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Wow, that's awesome. Focusing my thoughts doesn't mean that I'm denying reality. It just means I'm not going to give the majority of my thoughts on all the negative stuff, on all of the things that are partial truths, that are not moving me forward and building the life that I want to live in God. So I'm going to focus on what's true and what's right and what's pure. I'm going to just let that be the focus. It reminds me of a story of a couple and their 4-year-old son were on a road trip, driving through a particularly beautiful part of the countryside of where they were at, and they saw a sign that said Naturist Camp. And they said, well, we love nature and camping. And so they turned down the road and they saw someone riding a bicycle coming their way about a mile into this, and it wasn't long before they realized that the person's naked on the bicycle, and then what Naturist Camp meant kind of sunk in, and they decided, well, we need to distract the 4-year-old, so it's like, oh, look over there, and it didn't work. The 4-year-old is looking, and eyes are getting bigger, and then looks back at his mom and dad and says, oh, he wasn't wearing a helmet. It's about focus. It's about focus. Which reminds me of another story. My daughter moved back to Chula Vista a few years ago and was looking at possibly signing up over at LA Fitness. So she wanted to take a tour. So she's going through the facility with one of the employees and came around a corner, and then out from a door comes Pastor James. She goes, oh, hi, James, I'm just thinking about joining. Hey, what do you think of the place, you know? And starts asking him some questions, and he's like, yes, no, just very short answers, and obviously wants to move on. So it's like, oh, okay, well, I'll see you later. Continues with the tour. And the next day, and she tells me about this encounter, and next day I said, hey, I heard that you ran into Heather at LA Fitness. And James goes, oh, yeah, I came out of the locker room, and it's like 5 steps to the pool, and I was just going to jump in, and I was just not comfortable having a conversation in my Speedo. It's about focus. Those two conversations were very different, you know? It's like, my eyes are here. It's so easy to lose focus with just the crush of, you know, kids' sports programs, get to this appointment, that appointment, bills, job, you know, relational hassles, you know, all of the stuff. It can just be crushing. And we all have things that trip us up. We all have stuff that we want, and, you know, we've got sin that we struggle with. You know, we've all got our own issues, challenges, things we worry about. But look at Philippians 2. For God is working in you, giving you the desire and the power to do what pleases him. If you've ever felt like, I don't have the power to follow God. I just don't have enough strength to fully follow God. I know. So does God. He knows. That's why he not only gives you the desire, the want to, he'll give you the power. That is a wonderful, wonderful promise. Now, the surest way to live a powerful life, then, is to listen to what the Holy Spirit is saying with a yes in your heart. With a, okay, yes, Lord, I want to follow you. Live that way. And every now and then, you're going to get selfish or lazy, and you're going to go your own way. Okay, and then quickly turn. Say, no. Quickly turn. It's not about living it perfectly. It's about repenting quickly. Be a quicker repenter. God never stops seeking us. He's continually wooing us. He's speaking to us. He's wanting to lead us at every stage and age of our lives. Look at Isaiah 46. I will be your God throughout your lifetime until your hair is white with age. I made you and I will care for you. I will carry you along and save you. Man, that is a great picture of a God who absolutely loves us. A guy named Karl Barth. He was one of the most influential theologians of the 20th century. And he had a question from a theology student one time. Here was the question. What do you believe is the most profound theological truth? And here was this great theologian's response. He looked at the student in this classroom and said, Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. That was it. That was the deepest response to the deepest theological question. You see, to grasp the love of God, to get it, we get stuck in the sorry cycle when we're not grasping the love of Jesus. I mean, what if right now Jesus shows up and he's standing in front of you. I'm not suggesting that's me. I mean, right in front of you. I'm pretty close, but not quite a Jesus. And says, by the way, I just want you to know, you're not going to necessarily be able to see me, but I want you to know from this point forward, I love you, and I'm going to be right with you from right now to the rest of your life. I'll always be there. And you can talk to me about what you're facing. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, I'm going to lead you. You'll need to learn how to be sensitive to the Holy Spirit. You're going to need to learn how to listen. But I promise I'll always be there. Would you like to hear Jesus say something like that to you? He already did. He already said it. I'll never leave you, forsake you. So I'm sending the Holy Spirit to lead you and guide you, be your counselor, your comforter, your empowerer. He's already said it. What's the problem? We've got some jacked up ideas about how this thing works. God wants to help us straighten some of those things out. It's true of each and every one of us today. Paul prayed this prayer, and I pray that we will grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge. And you know, we're not going to fully get it. We're not going to fully grasp it by just the pages in this book, although it's powerful. And you might just go, well, you know, I'm not really a Bible person. I'm pretty jacked up. Read about these people. This is a book full of very jacked up people. I mean, there are some amazing sinners in this book. Amazing. You think you're a good sinner? Read this puppy. I'm telling you what. It's amazing. It'll give you great hope. See, we're not going to grasp it from knowing about it. In order to get it, we need to experience it. In our hearts, in our being. And to experience it, we have to do two things. Seek it. You have to pursue it. Investigate it. Pray. You know, I don't know how to pray. Well, here's what praying is. It's called talking. And if you can talk, that means that you can pray. It's not about knowing certain prayers. Just talk to God. Well, people will think I'm crazy. No, they'll think you're on the phone. Okay? Just talk to him. Talk to him. You seek him, and then surrender. That's how you experience this. How does this whole thing work? How do you start over? Number two, The Holy Spirit fills me. So many of the regrets in my life come from my efforts to fill empty or hurting or disappointed spaces in my life with things that can never fill it. I'm trying to fill something that, frankly, can only be filled in this relationship of love and acceptance and forgiveness with God. There's not enough stuff. There's not the right relationship. There's not the right achievements that can ever fill those. They can help you, but in a relationship with God, you can be bringing health to that relationship and to the career and to those achievements, rather than having to extract something, fulfillment from that relationship, that career, that achievement. So it's a vastly different scenario. Paul prayed this also, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God, to be filled with his peace and his joy, his power, his love, his purpose in your life. He wants to fill you with all that. And it's no problem-free promise. It's not about that. It's not like, and if you do this, if you surrender fully to God, your children will wake up tomorrow morning and they will get themselves ready and they will be kind to each other. And they will be saying, Mom, it's almost time to go. We're ready. No, they're still going to be sinners, little sinners. You're still going to have problems. There's still going to be issues. But you're going to come at those with a power greater than what's coming at you. You're going to be able to deal with whatever is coming your way, because there is a power within you that's greater. He that's within you is greater than he that's in the world. That's how he wants us to live. That's the life that we're invited into. That is awesome. As a matter of fact, to even fill that up a little more, let's look again at Ephesians 3. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever, amen. You see, he wants to be at work within us. He has begun a good work. He promises to complete that work, but we need to cooperate. We need to say yes. And it's not a one-time fix. It's a daily. Wake up with a yes in your heart. I love this simple prayer in Psalms 51. Matter of fact, let's read this one out loud together, and we do this with our outside voices. So you ready? Ready? Go. God, make a fresh start in me. Shape a Genesis week from the chaos in my life. I love that. It's not saying my life is awesome. It's saying, God, do something with this life. Work with it. This is all I got. Hand it to him. He wants to help you. He wants to fill you. He wants to empower you. What's your next right step? You know, for some of you today, you're taking that next right step in water baptism. The Bible says that when you come to a place of trusting Jesus, you make that decision, you step over that line of faith, that you're to follow that decision with water baptism. You're going public with your faith. And, you know, for many of you today, that's the choice you're making. After each of the services this weekend, we've been doing baptisms, not just here, but at all of our churches. And that's happening all over the place. And so there's a number of you that are here. You're ready to go get baptized after the service today. And I just want to say, way to go. That is so awesome. But there's some of you here that maybe you raised your hand when James said, you know, is that what you want, that... You know, I want to say yes to this God who is for me, not against me, who loves me. Maybe for you, that next right step is, I'm going to get baptized. I'm going to take that step. I mean, you know, some people sometimes, you know, in our culture, in our environment, how I grew up, how many of you grew up, well, I was baptized as a baby. So, you know, I don't really need to do that. You know, I already did that. And what would I tell my mother? That's usually the bigger issue. Or grandma. And you see, the Bible talks about baptism as a step that you take after your decision. So here's what I encourage people to say. Say, well, I got baptized not to undo what you did, but I wanted to confirm the decision you made for me as a child. Confirmation, baby. Trust me, it works every time. And then they go, oh, that's so cool. It turns into a whole different deal. So I encourage you to don't let that hold you back today. Go ahead and make that choice and that decision. As a matter of fact, when the Apostle Paul was finding his way to God, a Christ follower named Ananias said this, and now what are you waiting for? Get up, be baptized, and wash your sins away, calling on his name.